Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 31. So we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT No Gov license.
Yes, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Gov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today we're going to have Justin from Liberty Hangout, libertyhangout.org. I've actually interviewed him on my channel, so you can check out the background if you want. We're not going to go into, you know, how he became a voluntarist, because it'll be just a bunch of repeats. So, yeah, he's got a Facebook page, Twitter, and YouTube, all Liberty Hangout. Check him out there. And one common ground we're going to get into is, you know, he is also living in the People's Republic of New York. So we're going to get his take on that. What's it like? All the freedoms that we can avail ourselves of. and perhaps get into some fun gun control laws and, you know, do they help reduce crime? So, Justin, thanks a lot for coming to the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to have me on, Neil. How are you guys doing tonight?
Yeah, wonderful. So,
I'm dandy.
Yeah. Yep. So I've been living here all my life. I've slowly come to realize, you know, like as you learn about voluntarism, it's like, you know, you learn about all the things that you can't do, but that you didn't realize you couldn't do because you grew up not doing them being illegal, right? Isn't that interesting? You slowly are awakened to your own chains. So it's kind of an interesting awakening, you know, living in some place like New York. But I guess that realization would be a little more severe, you know, somebody growing up in North Korea, right? They're like, oh, I guess everyone doesn't have electricity like us. Right? So what's your take on New York, Justin?
It's interesting because when I was growing up, I had a real fascination for wanting to join the military. And I always saw, I always loved New York. I loved the military. I loved America. And so I kind of paired those two together. I would always, I always saw like the World Trade Center, the Freedom Tower. I saw it as an emblem of freedom. I saw
Freedom
New York
Tower.
As,
nice name, right?
Yeah. And I kind of viewed New York as the market capital of the world. And now, like, it was always my passion. That's why I wanted to go to college in New York, because this is where I wanted to be as I became an adult. And now I'm slowly realizing, well, actually very quickly realizing, that it's not the market capital of the world, it's the Marxist capital of the world. And so it's just funny how the city that I once saw as an icon of freedom, you know, you see the Statue of Liberty every time you you go past the New York here, yet you just realize just how much your freedoms are limited. You know, there's just so very little that you can actually do. And it's interesting how every other weekend when I go home, I have to take the train down to Washington Heights. And in Washington Heights, it's a very rundown community, big Dominican population over there. And they have a lot of street vendors there. And I know that in New York, for example, those are illegal. And so here we are, it's supposed to be the land of the free. And if you're poor, and like everyone always says, oh, don't you care about the poor? Yet these people that care so ardently about the poor vote these people into power that are going to squander the poor's opportunities and tell them that if you have something of value that you want to offer to society, you can't do that.
Well, you don't have the proper permit. That's the problem. Because, you know, what happens if somebody gets sick from some of that food you're selling? That's the ridiculous argument here. But yeah, you're right. It's insane. I mean, heck, I'm somebody who was, I was born here. I was luckily moved out at a very young age, so I didn't even realize it. But then I chose to come back here at the age of 16, and I haven't left since. And it's got, oh Jesus, now that I think about 22 years later, I'm still in this godforsaken state.
Channel your inner Kurt Russell, man. I keep telling you, just escape from New York.
Yes.
And just one thing I must point out, it's only a state if you believe it's a state.
Well, this is true. This is true. Well,
would you say that believing in a state is a state of mind?
Ooh. Dave's trying to get deep on us here.
We're going real deep here with Justin from Liberty Hangout.
All the quandary of the mind here.
Yeah.
What is life, you know? Like, what is it, you know?
I didn't know we were getting the existential Dave tonight. So you got to warn us about this.
I mean,
thing.
Sometimes
as
it comes
to,
out,
as
you know,
to the nihilistic Dave. Right?
Oh shit! Here we go. Sometimes I have bad flashbacks, guys. Okay, I get real introspective.
Yes.
I think my first real run-in with just how much New York is under a siege came a couple years ago. I was going to a Mets game, and I had to travel the subway all the way from up here in the Bronx all the way to Queens late at night. And so typically when I ride the subway, I carry a knife with me because obviously guns are basically outlawed here in New York. And so I like to at least have some sort of mechanism of defense. Yet you're going to a baseball game, they don't allow you to have any mechanism of a defense there. So I was in a hole where I can't even travel from the Bronx to the Queens, very dangerous subway ride at that time of night. So I was left defenseless going there and coming back late at night. And so that was my first real run-in with knowing just how limited my freedoms are here in the People's Republic of New York.
You didn't want to turn into Bernard Goetz?
you don't need to be protected. That's what the cops are there for. Come on now.
That's what the transit authority is there for, Justin.
Yes, the MTA, those wonderful gentlemen at the MTA, like the ones that harassed, cuffed and threw me in a cage earlier this year, all because I refused to give over my license when I wasn't required by law to do so. Those guys, they're to protect you.
You disobeyed one of the king's soldiers, you know? They're acting under the king's authority, man. Come on.
No, but you're right, though. And that's something that a lot of people, it just goes right over their head. They don't even think about it. Because like you said, you don't realize the freedoms that you don't have. Because in most people's mind, if you bring to them the idea that you are not as free as you think you are, like every time I see that, my mind immediately goes to the Inigo Montoya meme about, you know, freedom. You keep using that word. It doesn't mean what you think it means. Because most people just assume that freedom is just more than what the other guy has, because they look at North Korea, they look at China, they look at these places and goes, well, they're not free over there, but we are. We, you know, people think, oh, I can get out and go in my car and drive wherever I want, at whenever I want.
People
and
believe
that means I'm free.
People believe that permissions are freedom.
Well, yeah. I have the I was told I have the right to do this now.
It reminds me of
that means I'm free.
It reminds me of this the Braveheart meme I saw somebody post. It's like, they may take our lives, but they will never take 40% of our income, our ability to ingest our, you know, our substances that we want, you know, just the ability to do things without a permit. He's like, oh shoot, wait a minute, hold on.
What was I talking about? You know, I saw that the other day. No, it's so. I mean, I couldn't imagine living in New York. I mean, I'm one of these people that, if I leave my property, I have a gun on me. Like I, if you see me out in public, I'm armed. And I couldn't imagine being able to having to hide that, you know. And it's so stupid. I don't know why the people of New York haven't forced this into court. I mean, how is it even possible to ban constitutional carry?
I think what's most ironic is that a lot of people on the left will say, like, oh, well, what do you really need a gun for in certain areas? Well, in all the areas that they say it for, if you look at the crime statistics, yeah, you do sure as hell need a gun in New York, where crime is through the roof compared to places like Alabama.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, there's some bad areas in Alabama that, you know...
Well, Birmingham, yeah.
Unless you're wearing a police uniform or the right color, you probably shouldn't go into. But, you know, the thing is in Alabama, you just really don't – I can't tell you the last time, unless I'm talking about, like, two drunk people getting in a fight at a bar or something. I can't tell you the last time I saw two people just do some crazy shit because everyone down here is armed. Like, you go walk through Walmart, and there's – like, the guy in front of you will have a pistol on his hip. And, you know, it's, you know, I'm safer seeing that, especially when there's not like a, you know, a police badge beside the pistol. But, you know,
yeah, I actually had the argument in class the other day. We were talking about gun control, And I remember someone was saying how, like, oh, you know, if, even if you have a gun, the reaction time is so blah, blah, blah. And they discount, they completely discount the fact that if you have no idea who's armed, you have no incentive to commit crime in the first place. But if you can count on your subjects being disarmed, how much greater is the incentive to use force to get what you want?
I told that to one woman and they, that exact argument, and she's like, well, people who commit crime are not rational. Like I said, because they would intentionally go out of their way to go to a gun-free zone, right, to commit a crime or a mass murder, right? So then they're like, no, they're crazy people. They don't think. They don't think about self-preservation. They're not rational. I'm like, they don't want to die.
Well, no, no, you know? Yeah. It's coupled with that. But then they're behind their argument, the counter-argument to Justin's point is, I don't think gun ownership is rational. Which is, to me, is ridiculous, because here's the bottom line, what we were talking about before we started the show, the striking at the root. If you're against private gun ownership, which I'm against public gun ownership, if you know what that means government owning guns. If you're against private gun ownership, why don't you take your happy ass over to somebody who's got a gun and say, give me your gun, I'm confiscating it, I'm going to turn it into the authorities. Just do that one time, and I promise you, hopefully, you will not ever do it again.
You know, I think a lot of people don't even rationally consider how gun control requires the guns of the state. Mm-hmm. They completely discount it. They only see guns in terms of private citizens. They don't see it in terms of, okay, gun control means we're giving all the guns to the to the biggest mass murderers on the planet.
Yeah, I mean, when's the last time a private citizen bombed a hospital?
Never.
I mean, the last time I can think of someone bombing a private citizen bombing a building, with an actual bomb would probably be Timothy McVeigh, and that was a government building. Which, I mean, it sucks those people died, but. I mean, if you're in the government, you're surviving off theft anyway. So, wow. Timothy McVeigh, one could make the argument that what he did wasn't wholly evil. I would consider it evil because that was unprovoked attack. But you know, that it was government building. You know, like I think I've said it before. If terrorists wanted to come over and just blow up government buildings, I'd have no problem with it. Like, hey, if they said, hey, we're not going to attack one U.S. citizen, it's only going to be government buildings, I'd be like, okay, that has no effect on my life. I don't know, we probably just got flagged hard on the NSA.
Capitol Hill, White House, go, be my guest.
Yeah, I mean.
Hey, NSA.
Yeah.
I'm probably going to get a knock from the FBI.
The knock on Dave's door sounds, starts in 3,
oh,
two,
shit, no,
one.
No. No, but seriously, I mean, I don't advocate bombing anyone, but you know, the thing is.
Oh, Jesus, it's another one of those, I'm not a misogynist, but.
No, I don't advocate.
You just stepped in it again, Dave.
I'm not a racist, but.
I don't like when people bomb places, but.
No, I think unless someone's.
I'm not advocating violence, but.
It's like the question for.
Dave, you really are a nihilist, man. Everything about you is.
There's no
way to nail you down. It's, you know.
No, I'm not. I'm not a nihilist because they believe in absolutes.
Like morality doesn't exist, but
exactly. That's their. Anyways, okay. what I was saying was, I would never advocate for bombing or actually harming another individual that isn't directly proposing a threat to you or currently putting you in physical harm. So that's why this whole, you know, the whole Timothy McVeigh or anything like that scenario doesn't pan out quite like how. Someone like Timothy McVeigh wanted his message to come out. You know, if he would have been guarding his own property and took out people, then one could make the argument he was doing the morally justified thing. But, you know, this whole thing, in I can't remember what we were originally talked about because we're on such a heavy tangent here, but to steer it back to
guns. I don't know how we got here, but
he's on bombs now.
No, No, no. Okay, if you all right, if you banned every bomb, if every gun just, if I could snap my fingers right now and say every gun is completely gone off the face of the earth, and the idea of making a gun is erased from everyone's head. All right, no guns. The next thing that they would be moving on to would be bombs and knives. Mm-hmm. And then after that it would be heavy rocks. Yeah. Don't walk around with a clenched fist. You know,
people don't realize that these are just objects. They don't see the person holding the object.
It's that perfect comic where the guy stabs the guy and he goes, "Oh my God, you stabbed that guy!" And then he has a baseball bat. "Oh my God, you hit him in the head with a baseball bat!" And then he has a gun and he said, "Oh my God, the gun killed that guy." It's like, what? Where do you like? You know, in Japan they tried to ban the samurai sword because so many, you know, ex-samurais or whoever would lose their feudal lord or whatever would go around that. I mean, that was the ultimate weapon to have. You'd kill 10, 20 people with a samurai sword. And so they tried to ban swords, but you can't, the sword doesn't just hop up off the ground and start killing people.
Yeah.
So you need swords to confiscate swords. You can go back and look at this in historical evidence. Exactly. And you know, how do you think they disarmed China? Do you think they just said, "Hey, if you go," Mao came in and said, "Hey, bring in your guns peacefully." No, it was, they sent troops in house to house, tore the houses apart, found the guns, said, "If you're caught with a gun, we're going to kill you or send you to a forced labor camp." Same way with Russia, same way with Germany, same way. And it's just, you see this, it's never ending. The trick of the useful idiot to ply into this self-defense. They want to take self-defense away because they don't want anyone hurting the state.
Yep.
And the useful idiot is the pawn in the whole thing because they're the most harmed.
I think another thing that maybe the reason that a lot of libertarians, conservatives, those in favor of the Second Amendment and self-defense may be losing the argument is because we're seen as pro-gun and not pro-self-defense. And so I thought about this last week. I got into a conversation with my roommate. He asked me, "Are you pro-gun?" And I thought about it, and I said, that's a misleading question. And in principle, it's no different than asking me if I'm pro-prostitution or pro-meth. You know, it's
right.
I mean, to say I'm for an object, that's a very subjective question. All that matters is that I'm pro-freedom. I can be pro-freedom and still anti-gun. All that matters is that I believe that you own yourself.
I'm pro-gun.
You just destroyed my whole argument right there.
I'm pro-gun.
Nice. Oh, yeah, he's really getting a knock tonight.
Yeah. No, he does often. Since he's in Alabama, he's safe with that. If I pulled that one out.
No. I wasn't trying to shit on your argument or your point. I agree. I'm pro self-defense, and the gun is one of the best forms of it. Mm-hmm. And that's you know, being pro-meth. I'm not pro-meth. If meth could be, meth is a scourge. If it could be wiped off the face of the earth, I would gladly push the button for that.
Absolutely. Maybe one day as humans advance and we adopt new methods of self-defense, maybe guns will be seen in the same manner as meth for all we know, you know?
Yeah. When I have my laser rifle that's programmed into my watch, it'll be okay, you know.
Oh, when I have a drone that's floating above me and it's just automatically picks up a threat and just vaporizes it, you know, with microwaves.
When I build the Death Star.
Well, I was gonna say earlier when we started talking about the gun control thing, you know, the whole idea when you're, you know, Dave, you were talking about, you know, you're down in Alabama, you go to Walmart and there's people with guns in front of you. I mean, that's the whole idea, which, you know, the leftists, the liberals, the SJWs, whatever, all sneer at when you'd say, you know, the armed society is a polite society. But to an extent, it's true, because like you guys were saying earlier, if you don't know who has one, or better yet, you do know who has one, then you're not most likely not going to mess with that person. And that would be that. I mean, that's the ultimate, you know, down the road where everybody has a personal drone. Like, that's the ultimate, the armed society where everybody has one flying over their head.
Yeah. But think about it. The most vulnerable victims of probably theft are going to be your little old ladies. If you have no idea if a little old lady is armed, guess what? That woman's safe now.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, I mean, it's an argument that was played out by the NRA in their better days, I guess, before they became as entrenched with the political system as they are, but the whole, you know, it's an, you know, it was presented as an equalizer. Mm-hmm. And that's what it is for the defenseless, for the people who, you know, people ask why do you need a gun? Well, because you don't know what's going to happen. And, you know, you don't know when you're going to be overwhelmed. And especially if you're somebody who, in general, is more vulnerable than the next guy, whether you're a little old lady, whether you're a younger girl or even a younger guy who's not trained in any kind of self-defense and has never, you know, bothered to get into a fight or learn anything about, like, you know, you can get overwhelmed quickly. And it's so funny because people are so programmed to be afraid of these things because that's what gets fed to them by the media. That's what gets fed to them by the bulk of the politicians. You know, even the ones that are supposedly pro Second Amendment still find their way to weasel into saying, well, yeah, we still, you know, in order to please everybody in their base, oh, we still have to have some common sense. Like, mm-hmm. you know, because even people like these days, like, you know, Ted Cruz, who, you know, touts himself as one of the, you know, hardcore Second Amendment guys. It's like, okay, you're Mr. Constitutionalist, right? You're a big, you know, you're pro Second Amendment, right? All right. How do any of the gun laws that have ever been passed on a federal level jive with that piece of paper that you hold so hallowed? And then they just stammer and, well, you know, it's, oh, there has to be some limits. Well, no, you know, there is no limits to freedom. You're either free or you're not.
There's not an asterisk behind shall not be infringed.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, obviously, you know, the four of us here, I would assume, well, I know the other two, but I assume you would too, Justin, don't really hold the Constitution in as much reverence as other people would. So yeah. you don't need that because, you know, you don't get that right to self-defense from a piece of paper. Yeah, you don't get it from a piece of paper, from some arbitrary edict. And in actuality, I mean, I know that'll lead Dade to another tangent, but I'll say it anyway. The whole idea of rights in the first place, I mean, you don't have any rights beyond what you can provide for yourself.
Yep.
That's one thing that a lot of, you know, so many of these guys that they say, well, it's, you know, it's the argument on both sides, I think, is ridiculous when it comes to gun control. Because you have the leftists and the SJWs and the anti-gunners or whatever they call themselves or what the other side calls them.
They call ourselves gun sense.
Oh, yes. Yep.
We need gun sense.
Common sense gun laws, yes.
Right.
We need common sense gun laws. Like, no one should have a gun except for the government. That's
What would you guys say to those that are going to make the argument, well, don't you want to at least keep guns out of the hands of the mentally ill? Because I get that pretty often.
Yeah, I would, and I would start with half the police force. I would say this.
If someone says that mentally ill people shouldn't have a gun, I would ask,
why does the government have guns?
I would ask, does a mentally ill person have the right to free speech? Mm-hmm. And of course they're going to say yes. And I say, okay, then how can you be for one and not the other? Because that's in the Bill of Rights. If you're taking away gun ownership, you might as well take away all the other Bill of Rights and throw it in the trash. So yeah. You can't argue on a rational basis with someone who's anti-gun, or let's give babies guns. You can't argue with that person either. So, you know, I'm for common sense, legitimate common sense gun ownership. And here's the basis of the thing. You said earlier. You think that pro-gun activists are losing the debate. They're not. Mm-hmm. More states are loosening their gun controls. Firearm ownership is at its all-time high in the United States. Yep. And more states are passing constitutional carry. I doubt California or New York ever will. But
hey, we have the SAFE Act and we're proud of it.
Wow, we're so safe.
It keeps us safe.
No, you can't.
Politicians wrote it.
You have to look at the bread.
It says right there, safe. See?
Yeah, keep your guns in a safe and give the government the key.
Exactly.
I just wrote it, so we're safe.
The SAFE Act. Yeah. But you know, they're losing the anti-gun argument horribly right now.
Yeah.
They are. The president just got fucking kicked out of that town in Oregon. They said, we don't want you to come here. Banning guns isn't going to fix this problem. This is a wild lunatic.
Yeah.
You know, and I hate to say it. These people die, and you almost feel sad for these people because this could all be prevented by the schools hiring private security guards.
Yep. or the students carrying themselves.
I think that would scare. See, here's the problem, the scenario that runs through anti-gun people's head. They think back to the Wild West where everyone's in the saloon and they all got guns on their hips and then a wild gunfight breaks out. They think that's what would happen 9 times out of 10. But if you go back and look, there's a great book on the Wild West and it had some of the lowest per capita, unless you're an Indian, it had some of the lowest per capita gun-related homicides ever.
Well, yeah.
And you look at cities all across America. There's a town in Texas. There's 12 guns for every one person. They have the lowest gun-related incidents in the entire world.
Dave, wow. Are you saying my government history class was wrong?
And you look at Honduras. Honduras banned gun ownership. They have the highest gun-related homicide in the world. Switzerland has mandatory gun ownership. For every citizen of Switzerland, they have the lowest gun rate homicide in the world. Yeah. So the arguments are
when we were talking about the incentive to commit crime before, just look at the incentive to even invade a country. Hitler just skipped right over Switzerland.
Yeah. We're not going to mess with those guys.
All of the money was in the banks in Switzerland for the Nazi party.
Well,
but
that helped too, but yeah.
That helped greatly. Switzerland's, they're kind of a chaotic neutral. They're just like, hey, we'll take the money. Just don't fuck with us because we'll burn all the money.
Well, yeah, but that's, you know, like Danilo had about, you know, the history books being wrong. Of course, yeah, the Wild West wasn't so wild. I mean, there's a book actually by that title, the title, The Not So Wild West, right? There's definitely a really long article on Mises about that from years ago. Yeah. But
Tom Woods wrote about it also.
Yeah, he's right. You know, a bunch of people have written about it, but it's true. Yeah. If you actually look back, most people believe that because, well, they get their information from Hollywood. That's what they believe it was.
Isn't that the funniest thing when they watch a movie? You see, that's how it would be. That movie, Anarchy, The Purge. Is that what you want? That's.
Yes, but you ask him about any other movie in any other context. Oh, that's just fantasy. You know, it's the whole thing of not being able to see the big picture. You know, you were talking before about that one meme on guns. And I was trying to think, I saw another one that I actually thought was even better to point out the contradiction of that in the nature about, you know, blaming the situation, then blaming the gun. Well, the one I saw was, you know, some dentist shoots a lion and he's this horrible maniac and he's this horrible person who should be punished. But the kid in Oregon does it and it's the gun's fault. There's an even clearer example. How is it different? Right. How are those two situations different? Because there was one fuzzy man-eating animal on the other side that some puppy think is cute. Okay, then we'll blame the guy. But when it's, you know, when it's people, oh no, it's the gun. It's got to be the gun. Like it's so insane, because like with everything else in the statist paradigm, you have to ignore these blatant contradictions in order to attempt to make your point. Because when you point out the other side, unless you have to go into shutdown mode to not see that. It's, you know, that's why these anti-gunner type people stay that way, because you bring out the facts and they just shut down and put their fingers in their ears and la 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 la, and you must want to be one of those, you know, Tea Party conservative crazy nut jobs. No, it can't just be that you're anybody else who has some actual common sense and understands logic and can see every side of the argument and go, okay, that's where the problem is. Instead of seeing one side of it, focusing on that, you know, like I said, I think it's ridiculous. Yeah, are the pro-gun people losing? Probably, but they both have horrible arguments. Both sides have ridiculous arguments and they're just going back and forth at each other. But I, you know, just like everything else, that's by design. Divide and conquer.
I want to make two quick points. First, I want someone to go find that listens to this. I want you to go find the most watched FPS Russia video on YouTube and see how many views it has. And I want you to write it down on a sheet of paper. All right. And then I want you to go same website, YouTube. I want you to search up any gun control video that's pro-gun control and see how many views it has. I guarantee you that the FPS Russia one will have more views.
45 million views.
Yeah?
Wow.
So, all right. Oh, Justin's doing it. And the other point I want to make, and I know we're throwing around a lot of cliched things, but here's the bottom line. If you're not willing to take a gun from another person by force,
you shouldn't advocate someone else to do it.
Shut your fucking mouth. Like that's my thing. Like if you're not willing to take a gun,
this is from the show of subtlety and political correctness.
I was gonna Dave. Let's tell us how you really feel. Come on, don't hold back.
No, seriously. All right, seriously. If you're pro gun confiscation or any other regulation, you got to keep it at your home in a lockbox. Guns can't even be on your. You know, it's so asinine. Like if you're not willing to come to my door,
you got to put a sign on your front lawn. This is a gun free house. Right, yeah. Guns are banned in my house. Advertise it.
I'm gonna get a special sign made for my house that says this is the place that you're going if you trespass. There won't be any guns. So, or something like that.
You're gonna invite yourself in trouble there, Dave.
No, we're not moving. This I'd probably have neighbors be like, "Where the hell can I get one of those signs?"
until your local meth head figures out that you're announcing that you have guns, so you're like, okay, I'm gonna go in there and steal them.
Hey, I'm gonna be working from home, so he better come while I'm asleep. So. But this gun control debate is so stupid. Like, it's never gonna happen. That is the line in the sand for a lot, especially a lot of constitutionalists, especially a lot of right-wing people, Republicans, et cetera, et cetera. They'll play nice. They'll play the politics, but that is the line in the sand. They come for gun confiscation. I guarantee you we see some kind of secessionary movement really kick in or another civil war, which I don't think another civil war is possible at this point. I think the internet has kind of... You can't propagandize properly. The government can't propagandize properly because of the internet. But I think what you would have is people move to an area and say, hey, if you don't want guns over there, don't have guns over there. Over on this area, we're going to have guns. Texas would secede if they passed gun confiscation or banned guns. Texas would secede. And the United States can't lose the tax revenue from Texas.
Well, I think that Obama he's going to sign some sort of executive action, and then Hillary Clinton said she would pass some sort of executive action on guns. Bernie Sanders has said the same. Donald Trump has said the same. So I think we're kind of moving towards that path.
You can't ban gun ownership.
Well, they're going to try.
You can't. Yeah. Even executive action can't.
They know that it. Even through Congress, they would never be able to achieve such a thing.
No,
they're just, but it's the long con that's being has been played for quite a while now and is going to continue, and they know that. I mean, I've spoke to this before. The whole idea of not just, you know, the U.S., just the state in general, and how it's grown and how it's modernized over the years, and each one has, you know, each empire has learned from the last one, and they know now that they, you know. Things like what happened in Germany with when Hitler came to power, and then, you know, weeded out all the Jews in rather short order. I mean, when you think about it, from the time that he took power and then slowly started changing everything, and then put the laws in place, and then the camps started and all that stuff. Like in the scope of history, that was a very short, like minuscule amount of time. That can almost, because of the aforementioned internet that Dave said, that can almost most likely never happen again at that pace anywhere. It doesn't, any place other than like Korea where it's happening now, in North Korea where it happens like already, like that will never be able to happen again on that great a scale that quickly. Everything has to be done at a much slower pace, and the latest empire knows that. They've learned from everybody else's mistakes. I mean, you can go back in the history books and see people, you know, like Teddy Roosevelt picking up like the original progressives and how they had this affinity for fascism and communism, and they put it in different terms, and imperialism, and
planned capitalism. That was their term.
Yeah,
industrial. State-ran industrial, I can't remember what it...
Yeah, but they... Well, exactly. They changed the language just like anything else. You know, that's the whole idea behind political correctness is just you change the language slowly. Or it's, you know, it's the frog in the pot scenario. You change it slowly over time, and it just becomes accepted into the vernacular. And then people are... you know, the next generation is pre-programmed with that, and it's the same thing. So they've been at this for a very long time, and I think you're more right, Justin. They'll continue pushing towards that, and they'll just keep chipping away, just like with everything else. They, you know, it's the whole idea. I mean, what was it? You know, I think you had mentioned it might have been before we started the show about you know, when you started getting into these things and coming at it from a conservative perspective, and then, you know, you slowly start researching because you want to learn stuff and you want to learn how to attack the left more, mm-hmm. you know, in a better way to get your point across better. And then you start going down the rabbit holes and you're like, hey, wait a minute, there's a hole here and there's a hole here. You know, like that happened. That's the same thing happened for me. I was somebody who was a hardcore, you know, I was a hardcore constitutionalist, and I slowly went down the path. But you see these things. And it's all of a sudden it's like, well, wait a minute, if they wanted to take the guns away, they would have already. No, they're just going to do it slowly, and they've learned. They're just going.
Can I make a counterpoint?
Well, no, I was just let me finish, then you can. The thing that turned me on to this was learning about what they call milker bills, where they purposely put up certain legislation just to get other companies to agree, corporations to agree with what they want, by putting up a bill that they have no intention of passing, that just scares the piss out of these bigger corporations. So they'll pour money into the other side, what they think is the other side, to get the votes to go their way. And then they end up with what they want anyway. So like, that was my end. When I saw stuff like that happening, I'm like, wait a minute, they're all playing together, and this is how they get away with it. So that's what they do. They just constantly throw out lines. And every once in a while, when one of, you know, the whole never let a good crisis go to waste, they test the waters every time, and they will take as much as they can every time. Every little incremental win they can get is a huge bonus for them, because in the eyes of the anti-gunner civilian population, it's not enough. But to the people that are pushing this shit, they're like, they're more than happy to take these little steps, because they know it's going to slowly build towards that, as long as nobody else steps up and says, we're not going to take it anymore. Because as much as I'd like to believe what you were saying earlier, Dave, about that line in the sand, I don't think as many of those people really have that hardcore line as they say they do. Some of them I've met, I would believe it. You know, some like the 3%ers and the, you know, people like that. But other ones,
I know where I'm speaking truth.
No, and I get it. But a lot of them still let themselves get walked all over in so many other situations. It's like, well, that's your one line in the sand. Okay, so they'll let you keep your gun, but they'll tax the crap out of everything else. You'll not have any money to do anything. And then they'll find a way to slowly outlaw or heavily regulate the ammunition. So, you can have your freaking gun, but good luck getting ammo unless you're cranking it out yourself.
They could, they could just do the Stamp Act on ammo.
they could do anything.
But no. My counterpoint is there's, out of the 50 states in the United States, 38% or 38 of them are Republican governors and completely Republican controlled. 38. All right. I don't think that any kind of gun banning, even if the worst atrocity ever happened, like let's say a kindergarten got shot up by a bunch of people. Let's say a black kindergarten got shot up by like 20 white supremacists and killed every baby inside. It would be impossible. So here's the thing. It's pointless to argue right now, but I do believe that this is the line in the sand for a lot of people, especially, you know, not everybody in America is big city, you know, liberal arts degree, et cetera. You know, there's people out there that just don't want to be fucked with. They don't really care what the government does. Just don't mess with me.
Yeah.
And you know, when you get out here, especially in the South and in Texas and in Nevada and in Oklahoma and stuff like that, you know, we don't see government agents all day. I see a cop maybe once or twice a week. So yeah. I guarantee you, Justin walks 5 minutes around the block, he sees two cops.
Oh, all the time.
So yeah, I don't see that. So it's all programming. You get used to that, and whereas, you know, it might take an hour to 20 minutes for the cops to come out in some of these places and where I live, and you best better have a fucking gun.
Yeah, going back on what Jeremy was saying about how the state can't get away with things it used to anymore, I agree 100% on that. However, I do think that, like, just looking at historical trends and also just looking at the current economy, I do believe that the country is on its last legs here. And I feel that in an attempt to just keep its power, it may just take these extreme measures. So we see that the petrodollar is going to fall soon. And that right there may unravel the whole entanglement. And I think that they're just going to fight so vehemently to cling to that power that they are going to take these measures that they even know they won't be able to get away with.
Yeah, no, I'll concede my point on that. That yeah, you're right. If it comes to that, absolutely. I think they will definitely amp it up to the dying breath. They'll do whatever they can. Absolutely. I agree with that.
I think the difference there though is that like in what you were saying is that they're just not going to get the support of the people, but they'll still take the same measures. That's going to be the difference there, is that the people won't be on the side of the state this time.
Yeah, and that's the funny thing when people think that, you know, voting for politicians to solve our problems, as if politicians always have, you know, are the people's best intentions in mind. and really, you know, they're really power hungry control freaks, right? Sociopaths and sociopaths do not yield their power willingly, right, or easily. And and once they see the empire crumbling, the petrodollar fall, and all the worthless Federal Reserve notes come flooding back to the U.S. and people realize how con they were and how how worthless they truly are, then things will shift, right? And hopefully another empire will not be created out of the ashes, right? If we can reach as many people as possible, that's my hope. So
I think even in that event, like, I know that there are a lot of, I see it split amongst ANCAPs. A lot of people want to see the system collapse right away, because the quicker you can get a collapse, the quicker you can actually rebuild. And then there are a lot of ANCAPs who fear that and would prefer, like your Tom Woods, would prefer to get a Rand Paul and just kind of ease it in, ease liberty in. But I feel like if we did have a collapse, I feel like maybe society, you would just kind of have, maybe it would go back to 1776, and that you had all these different states. So you can say that in a way that back in 1776, back when you had the Articles of Confederation, that was similar to the, you could say that was like a minarchist state in a way. And it was almost voluntary, and that you had all these different states with all these different interests you could move to. So maybe perhaps once the system falls, we'll see something like that. And then because we already have the seeds of liberty planted on the ground, irony right there, seeds of liberty. and so now that we have this plant, we have nice. all these great people that have this philosophy. Like they didn't know the philosophy of voluntarism back in 1776. So all it takes is a few people with a great idea, and it's just going to spread like a wildfire.
I think what's going to happen is, I don't think in 20 years there will be a United States of America, especially if there's a complete petrodollar collapse. You're going to have, you just think about all the people that are on welfare, that check's not coming. It's going to be complete pandemonium when the dollar collapses in some areas.
In the cities,
Baltimore, New York, Detroit,
Jeremy, all three of us Chicago. Live in the city, right?
Yeah, of course. Well, New York is just the city, the whole state.
It's a big city.
Here's the thing though. I maybe it's just because it started to deteriorate and people started to flood out of it beforehand. But that whole idea of just in the time of collapse, like this chaos erupting, like look at what happened in Detroit. The city fell, essentially. Like the government there just collapsed. They went bankrupt and they started doing nothing. And yes, certain areas were already bad to begin with and got a little worse, but there isn't that chaos that you would expect. And like,
well,
I said,
you still have people living off federal subsidies in Detroit, though.
I know, I understand that.
The safety net is it's battered and broken, but it's still there.
Yeah, but it's not. But I'm saying it may be because so many people have there was an exodus, for the five to 10 years leading up to the official collapse. So maybe that had something to do with it. But I mean, we've discussed this before. Yes, will certain people go into complete panic mode? Absolutely. But maybe it's just the optimist in me, but I really believe that there are a lot of people on the government dole at the present time that are there honestly, that are there because they just had nowhere else to turn. And whether it was from their own bad decisions or just happenstance, whatever it is, and whether they just got sucked into the system and just, you know, and just found it harder and harder to get out, because you hear these stories all the time about these people that find job opportunities and get excited and then find out that by taking this job opportunity so they can say to themselves and to the people around them, I'm not taking assistance anymore, I'm doing the right thing, they actually end up making less money than they would, or because of the taxes that will now get taken out, they're actually going to be put in a worse position than if they stay on it. So then they stay on it a little while longer until they find something. Like, there's so many people out there that are in that position that if the rug gets pulled out from under them, will it suck? Abso-freaking-lutely. But will they panic and immediately turn to violence or just die? I don't think so. I think a lot of those people will be like, okay, I now have to get my ass in gear and figure out something so I don't die. I have to do something to make my family survive. And in the case of a collapse where the government laws no longer have any bearing, all those people that may have been held back by government regulation, by having a business idea that they couldn't start, by having the aforementioned food cart that was illegal at the time, now all of a sudden they can start selling crap on the side of the road. People will do that, and I think a lot more people will be better off than you're alluding to, Dave. That's just my
feeling. I think there will be. I mean, you won't see a big change of life in the rural areas.
Well, absolutely not.
But what I'm talking about is, you know, big cities that are centrally planned and completely artificial. You know, like, if you think New York City could sustain without government power, that's you're a lunatic. So I would see you would see mass exodus from these big cities. They would completely collapse, in my opinion.
I think we can just use basic economic theory here to perhaps predict some sort of chaos, and that people are incentivized. And so, even like you were saying about Detroit, we didn't see that chaos, but when you look at the incentives for people, they still had that safety net of federal subsidies. So once you remove that rug and people can no longer pay for the roof over their house, they can't pay for food, they can't pay for gas, what incentives do they have left? I mean, some may be able to go to the roadside curb and sell product. Other people may have an immediacy and panic. And I think right there, I think a lot of people, especially in the urban areas where they rely so heavily on these subsidies, they're going to panic, just like we saw in 1929, except on steroids.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I also think that the United States will break up into 5 to 8 mini states, and I'm against states, but I think that it's going to be a natural progression across the whole world. I mean, you're looking at Catalonia right now; they're trying to secede from Spain. You look at
well, they've been doing that for a while now.
I think it's actually going to happen this year, and you look at whatever the reasons are. Power's being more decentralized. It's being pushed more decentralized across the globe in a trend that is slowly going to grow. And when you see huge provinces in China say, you know what, we're going to be our own country, and you see huge places in Russia, like if you're in Siberia, the people in Moscow live a completely different life than you. So why are we not our own country here, you know? Mm. And in Alaska, why is Alaska part of the United States? Life in Alaska is like none other in the United States. That could be its own country right there. You know, Texas, you know, I think Texas will be the biggest and most successful state in this breakup, and I think that's what's going to happen. I think it's inevitable that it breaks up given enough time, obviously, but I think it's going to happen sooner than later, because the petrodollar is being artificially propped up, and unless the global banker's next move is to push a one world global digital currency, I don't, and I think that will be wholly rejected by people, and will either have to be enforced so stringently that it will be so chaotic across the world that the bankers will end up shooting themselves in the foot on this.
I think we're actually, if you don't mind me chiming in real quick, I think we're 12 days away from the IMF rolling out a new global currency.
Oh, yeah. I haven't even been following that, really.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I don't think a global currency, you know, Paul
but
Krugman.
Like you said, people aren't going to accept it.
No, they're not. It's going to fail. You know, there's probably already a global currency out there right now. But, you know, you have Bitcoin out there, and you have, you know, Amazon's could print its own cash and stock, you know, there's endless possibilities that what could happen outside of this government state-run coercive monopoly that we have. And I guarantee you, like, technology, the internet is
Mr. I don't do absolutes. Is that I guarantee you like five times.
No, I guarantee you that.
Just wanted to point that out.
I guarantee you that this whole grip.
I'm not a nihilist, but
you guys sure do like laughing at bad jokes. I love it. Anyways, it's like sand trying to hold on to a handful of sand. It's just falling out of their hands, this power over governments. And I think once these governments collapse and there's no government for them to have a fake currency, a monopoly money on, we're going to see what's going to happen. I Texas wants all of its gold back out of the Federal Reserve. Germany wants all their gold out. I've never heard of that in my lifetime until now. That's new. That's new countries wanting their money.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Our states wanting their gold.
You think World War III is ahead?
I think World War III, I think it might be ahead, but I don't think that it will be, I don't think there'll be 12 million Americans voluntarily entering the draft.
Yep.
If you get what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think it reverts back to what Jeremy and I were saying about people aren't going to accept it.
Well, that and all the nations all have a suicide gun put to each other's head. It's called mutually insured destruction. And, you know, America can't directly attack Russia. That's why you see all this political posturing in Syria.
Yep.
America can't directly attack Russia. Russia can't directly attack the United States. Britain can't directly attack whoever the fuck they want to. I mean, you blow everybody up if you do that. It's mutually insured destruction. And, you know, quite frankly, I'm pretty sure Danilo will agree with me on this one. I don't think anyone should have the power to vaporize pretty much all inhabitable area on Earth.
Yeah, you know,
just because political masters get upset at each other.
Even if the United States and Russia did directly attack each other, I think that the world is wholly different than it was just a decade ago. I mean, just a decade ago, the United States was marching into Iraq, marching into Afghanistan. I don't think that people identify with their government the same way we did just 10 years ago. I mean, they couldn't even get away with going into Syria 2 years ago. That shows how different the ballgame is today.
That's why I think another false flag is imminent, right? because people are wondering, like, why are we still in the Middle East again? You know, what, 14 years later? You know, it's like I think the high of after 9/11 of, you know, patriotism, everyone was like, go, invade, kill. You know, now people are like, wait a minute, what are we still doing there? What's going on? So I think they might. I definitely see that happening. You know, like another mass killing in a large city somewhere, and, you know, blaming another Middle Eastern country that has some oil, untapped oil that we haven't gotten yet.
You know, do you think they have the capabilities for it? And if they do, then why haven't they done so already?
I mean, it's just another last-ditch effort of a crumbling empire. You know, it's trying to cling to more power.
You have to think about this as well, Justin. Before 9/11 happened, there was no huge global conflict going on.
Yep.
So you have the government has all these contracts with Halliburton, with Lockheed Martin, with Boeing, and all this to make bombs, planes, guns, et cetera, et cetera. They need this to happen so they can get back into war to ramp up their contracts with these companies. Because senators get money from these companies. These companies, it's corporate welfare, and it's fascism. It's just in a big circle. So they need a boondoggle like Iraq and Afghanistan and Syria and Yemen and Somalia and Libya and et cetera, et cetera. They need that boondoggle to go on forever.
Yep.
So they can keep saying, hey, Lockheed Martin, here's a $18 billion contract. Here's a blah, blah, blah to Boeing. And when you have this peacetime, this global peacetime, no, none of those war profiteers are making money. Mm-hmm. So what they are greatly incentivized to have this happen. I don't know if it'll be a false flag in the United States. It might be in Britain. It might be in France or whatever. It'll be in one of the U.S. allied nations. And
maybe even Israel.
God forbid it be Israel.
Amazingly, they never seem to happen there. I don't know why that
is. Did you see the picture? Jeremy. Did you see the picture of the pipeline that goes from Israel to somewhere in Iraq? And it showed all of the Syrian, and it goes through Syria and Palestine, and it shows all of the ISIS-controlled areas, and the pipeline's going right through, and it's like, why hasn't ISIS blown up this pipeline giving oil directly to Israel? This doesn't make sense, does it?
I mean, I was only half joking about the Israel thing, but it, when you think about it, it's true. Why don't they ever happen there? I was going to say, though, I mean, false flag or not, I mean, at this point, unfortunately, it's so hard to discern. I mean, there's so many people that claim false flag over everything. And then there's certain things that have got borne out to be proven true. Like over the years, like you can never tell. For me, it falls into the category of not that I don't care, but it's not a high priority for me to worry about. Because if it's a false flag or not, to me, it's the result, is what happens after the fact. What's the aftermath? So when I look at these situations and I look at, you know, what Dave, you were saying about, you know, obviously, yes, the military industrial complex and all those people that need to make their money. Are going to be there, and they're going to want to keep making their money. But I don't think it's really necessary for them to have any major conflicts going on. Because what's that one statistic that's thrown around a lot? I've seen it on a meme a bunch of times, and I've actually checked it out, and it does seem to bear out to be true that, you know, America has been at war essentially for 222 out of the 239 years of existence. So this whole idea of this global peace has never existed. It's bullshit. There's never been global peace, because as long as there's been the state in some iteration or another, there has been factions warring against each other trying to gain more power. So this constant state of war, it's just now, you know, from the 20th century on, when fascism became fashionable and became the overarching theme in almost every major country, you know, whether they call it fascism or not, you know, the crony capitalism, whatever you want to call it, that paradigm that has been around, you know, since the beginning of the 20th century and moving forward, they're just going to continue. And so they don't, yes, was, you know, would it be helpful to have another boondoggle like Iraq? Absolutely. But they've been, you know, cruising along and making money with all this little BS, you know, half the stuff that people don't even realize is happening. You know, like I look back, like that's one of the things. I mean, I've touched on this many times before about how my in to anarchism was through history, because I became a history buff because I was a constitutionalist. I was a Tea Partier. I wanted to learn everything there was to learn about the Constitution and these so-called great men, the founding fathers, the framers, all these people. And I started digging further and further into it. And then I stumbled across what most people would consider, you know, bullshit revisionist history. Until I try to point out to them that no, the actual history was technically revisionist because they just made it up as they went along. So, you know, but all the, you know, this has just been going on, and they're just going to keep at it. It's not gonna, you know, it's not, they'll find a way to make money, and they'll just keep up with these little BS things. And that's what I was saying. You know, I look back and I look at stuff that was happening in like the 80s and 90s, and even leading up to 9/11, before I was really paying attention to anything. And it's like all these other little BS skirmishes and these BS, you know, missions and adventures and whatever the hell they called them, you know, like all these things were going on, and the overwhelming majority of Americans had no idea the entire time, or they maybe caught, you know, whatever the news gave them. So they had, you know, nobody has any idea really how much money was spent on all that crap. So like this stuff's been going on. So I don't think it's going to be, I mean, like I said, would it be helpful to have another big one? Yeah. But the Syria thing, you know, that you mentioned before, Justin, about how people, you know, they said no to that. Like, for me, that was when that happened, I was just accepting anarchism. Like, I was just officially calling myself an anarchist in public when all that went down. And it blew my mind when that happened, because I didn't see that coming. I didn't see people saying no. I was like, holy crap, like, there's enough people that are actually that war weary that were freaking out about this.
And you know what? It wasn't even just the people like you and I. It was a lot of the soldiers, too.
No,
remember,
exactly.
They were writing the pictures. I didn't sign up to fight for Al-Qaeda.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I think that was the big initiative there that led to us preventing a war.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, and then you saw miraculously a little bit after the soldiers and everybody didn't want to go to Syria, what happens? Oh, wow, ISIS just magically appears out of nowhere, the strongest terrorist network of all time and all this, and they're driving brand new Toyotas and Humvees and using American-made tents, and it's just like, something's fishy here. And, you know, Obama has a few slip-ups on national TV saying, you know, we're going to continue with our efforts of training and supplying ISIS. And like the next day he's got to go, I didn't mean to say ISIS. And you're like, well, I think you did, because you've obviously been saying it for fucking behind closed doors for months now. And you just happen to fuck up and say it on national TV. And, you know, Putin comes out on TV the other day and goes, hey, if you want to know who's funding ISIS, why don't you look and see who's paying them the most? Because I know how much they cost. I could be paying them right now. And that was like Toto walking up. That should be, for a lot of people, Toto walking up and pulling the curtain from behind the where the wizard was talking into the machine. Like, if at this point in time you do not realize that almost every terrorist cell, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, the Mujahideen, probably fucking Hamas, all of this, and ISIS, all of this has been funded by the West, by Britain, by Israel, and by the United States. You're blind to reason. Like, where are these fuckers getting this money from? They live out in the middle of the goddamn desert. All the oil is controlled by the kings or the dictator. Where are these terrorists getting the money?
Yeah,
they're not.
You know, whether it's, a lot of people will question that just for the fact of, you know, whether it's directly or indirectly, whether they directly created ISIS or whether it's indirectly, we can still look at history and know that, okay, it's fat. I was watching a video the other day showing how ISIS came to fruition. And so they're saying how the U.S. government funded, armed, and created Osama bin Laden. Fact. The U.S. government funded, created Saddam Hussein. Fact. The U.S. government funded and created ISIS, which was originally the Free Syrian Army. Fact. Mm-hmm. So whether or not they directly create ISIS is kind of besides the point to us knowing that they did, in fact, create ISIS.
The CIA has been doing this for years.
Yeah.
They want to overthrow a dictator and put in the same people with the same color of skin or religion or whatnot in power so they can control them. So if ISIS takes over Syria, right, they topple Assad. ISIS becomes the governing body of Syria and all of Iraq, which I honestly think that's what the United States government wants. They have their puppets controlling two nations, now one nation. And then you just spread that to, you spread that to Yemen, you spread that to Iran, you spread that to Libya, and then America's controlling 20 nations now. That's all one nation controlled by an Islamic fundamentalist caliphate, and the purse strings and the money is all being held by America and Israel. And if ISIS was really wanting to do some shit, they would go topple the most pro-Western Middle Eastern nation, which is Saudi Arabia. Why is Saudi Arabia's oil fields not getting terrorized? Why are their kings' castles not getting bombed? Why? Why is this? Why are they not? It's because there's tons of military U.S. military bases in Saudi Arabia.
What do you think we're going to see in Iran in the coming years?
They don't have a central bank that's controlled by the international bankers. So, I think what you'll see is a false flag pinned on Iran. Or you'll see what I said, Syria and Iraq will form one nation, call it ISIS, call it the Islamic State, whatever you want to call it, and the Islamic State will wage war with Iraq, so it'll be like America never...
Yeah.
You know, I've already told people this on this this podcast before, that Iran is in such, they're such a little threat to the United States, or pretty much anyone outside of their geopolitical position on the map. United States gas and oil companies are the number one importer of gasoline to Iran. Okay, so all you would have to say is, all Obama would have to say, or any president or whatever, say, hey, Chevron, Shell, BP, whatever, if you want to continue doing business in America, the largest oil-consuming nation in the world, if you want to continue doing business with us, you cannot sell oil, or you can't sell refined petroleum to Iran in any way, shape, form, or fashion. If you do, we will ban you from using or doing business in the United States. You take Iran and you cut off 80 to 90% of their gas, because they have oil, they just don't have refineries. So they get their oil, they ship it, American companies refine it and send back the gas. So you cut Iran's gas off, their whole country goes belly up. So this whole thing that Iran is they're a problem is such a farce that it's not even funny. And you sit up there and you watch the Republican debates, and you watch 5-10 jackasses talk about how Iran is the biggest threat to American safety in the world.
Yep.
You know, it's so funny. I saw a map the other day. I think I told Danilo about it. It was a map, and it was, they polled people in every country in the world, who is the biggest threat to the world today.
And they all said the United States.
All of them said all of them said the United States, except for America, which said, yeah, Iran.
I think Canada said Iran too.
No, Canada didn't say Iran.
Are you sure?
They might have said Iran as well, but
yeah.
South Korea said North Korea was, and North Korea said South Korea was. So obviously, they don't really matter. But you know, like, it's just funny when you and I say this a bunch, and Jeremy's said it before on this podcast. It's really hard to see outside of the empire when you're in it.
Yeah.
Like, when you're living in the empire, it's hard to see what's going on outside of it. You know, you take the average pro-war neocon war hawk and drop them off in Baghdad or Ramadi or anywhere else like that, and let them see what America has done to these places.
Yeah,
they would probably throw up. They would be so distraught. I mean, it's dehumanizing. It's horrible.
I think that's why it's so helpful that a lot of voluntarists, when we run into veterans, I just think the message is just so much stronger when it's coming from someone who's seen this and been a part of it firsthand. You know, that's why Adam Kokesh, he can get away with, the message just resonates that much more with him. He can approach people and say, oh yeah, by the way, I'm a veteran, so like, I've done this firsthand. I tortured people.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, we've had Donnie Gebert on our show, who does our, well, occasionally does our Force to Freedom podcast, but he talked about that. We did a whole episode on that, about how to talk to military members, and how it is, you know, at least especially, you know, from his view too, it's much easier for somebody like him who spent 19 years in to be able to talk to people who are either still in or veterans or whatever, because there's a natural trust there.
Yeah.
That is often not there between a veteran or an active duty member and a civilian. You know,
yeah, whereas someone like us, we're going to be branded as, we're anti-military.
We're just hippies that want to live on a commune.
Yes.
they totally mislabel us.
we're commies, we're hippies, we're liberals, we're, you know, anything but what we are.
It always cracks me up too. I get called a communist by military military members who collect the government check, and we're in the socialized military. And I'm like, I'm the communist? I've never done any of those things. You're the one that was taking the government paycheck and obeying edicts from government.
Yes,
for the largest welfare institution in the country is the military. So you're sitting here telling me I'm the commie? No, I am so far anti-communist that Pluto is communism, and I'm wherever the sun is, 10,000 billion light years ahead of it.
You know, you raise an interesting point there about how the military is the largest welfare program in world history, and especially here in the United States, because every time I get into a debate with conservatives and we talk about how they don't want immigrants coming to the United States because they're afraid they're going to collect welfare benefits, yada, yada, yada. And then my rebuttal is often to, okay, so if we're going to justify using violence against people because they are receiving benefits from the government, would you justify using violence against the military, who are members of the biggest welfare program in the country, and then they'll say, like, oh, no, they deserve it. And then I follow that up with saying, like, how does one person deserve stolen money but someone else doesn't? Like, how does anyone deserve stolen wealth?
Justin, just be quiet, man. You're making too much sense. I don't want to think about these things. I just want to, you know what? Go America, rah, rah, rah. I'm going to turn on the NFL. I'm gonna sit back with my cold Miller Lite, and I'm just going to, you know what? I'm going to pet my rifle, and I don't want to think about these things.
Yeah. I think, yeah, like, discussions like that, that's where I believe that, whatchamacallit, nonviolent communications is really helpful, because I just feel like you're nationalists. That's where a lot of conservatives are just really, really emotional. It's when it comes to the military. And they can't explain why.
None of them will explain why. If you ask, why are you so pro-America? Why? Explain to me. Well, it's the home of the free. Where do you see freedom at? It stands for the value. What exact values do you share with America right now? And they'll say all this stuff that isn't really happening.
Yeah.
America's does none of that.
Yeah. I made the mistake of doing my first street interview at my local Memorial Day parade, where all the nationalists were out high and proud. And so I went out by myself, too. I didn't have anyone else with me.
Brave.
That's ballsy and stupid. But
hey, I'm a one-man show. I'm trying to grow my website.
It's ballsy, because I kept talking about doing stuff and I haven't done it yet. But I've seen what happens to some guys, unfortunately. I mean, luckily you're still here, so obviously it wasn't that bad.
Yeah, I only got two interviews in. Like, the first one actually went real well. I had this elderly lady. I was giving her some really good questions, and it was thought-provoking to her. I was like, "Do the troops fight for your freedom? What freedoms are they protecting? Well, you can do this." And then I said to her, I was like, "You know, I can't even feed the homeless. I can't even open a lemonade stand. We have more laws than any other country, the biggest prison population in the world." And then I interviewed another woman, and I probably jumped into it very, like, way too quickly, because I asked her, I was like, "Do the troops protect freedom here in America?" She said, "Yes, they do." And I said, "What freedoms are they protecting?" She's like, "Oh, you know, just your regular, ordinary, everyday freedoms." And then I asked her my next question. "So what freedoms were protected when we went to Iraq and overthrew Saddam?" And then she was like, "No, forget it. Take me off the camera." and then I cut the camera, and she was yelling at me, "Oh, it's a family day. How dare you do this?"
I don't want to think right now.
I've seen some of those those one man videos like that, where people, like, they get violent over it because like you said, Dave, they can't explain why. Yeah. And that's the thing, because they don't, it's not even like, beyond even asking them follow-up questions when they give you that stuff. It's like, my question, I mean, but to your point, Justin, you know, maybe you got to ease into it with some people, because my first question would be, can you give me an answer that's not a cliche? Because so far, that's all you're telling me. Well, it's or just rhetoric that you were taught in school. Like, can you give me an actual answer? Can you actually, what does it mean to you? Not stuff you've been taught. You know, because it's the land of the free. Okay, we were all taught that in school. What does that mean to you? Elaborate, please. And that's where they get hung up, because they'll hem and haw, and then realize that if they realize that you're not in the same position as them, then they'll just react and call you a commie and freak out and run away, because they don't want to. Because it is. It's tough. It's hard to deal with. I mean, I know it was for me. We were talking about the military, you know, the military, or even just the nationalistic people. You know, when you're like that, it makes it that much harder, because not only have you been propagandized like everybody else, you took it to heart a lot more than other people. And it's that fear that overtakes you, because you have to, when you're somebody like that and you get this information presented to you, and it doesn't, I mean, it does matter how it is, but regardless of which form it takes, if somebody eases you into it or drops it on you, like, when you're presented with this information, this fear response kicks in, because it's like, you have to shut that down as quickly as possible, because any lingering doubt you have automatically turns you to, wait a minute, what else was I lied to about? Was I lied to about this? Is my whole life a lie? Like, all these things, like, because, I mean, it happened to me. Like, these things go flooding through your head, and it's like, well, that can't be possible, because
I don't even want to think about it.
Yeah,
I was explaining this to Daniel on the show that I did with him, how, you know what turned me into a voluntarist, or what started my whole transition? was just learning the truth about Abraham Lincoln. That was that spark for me. It whiskey, got me to question everything.
Whiskey rebellion for me. Lincoln was shortly after that.
I don't know exactly what it was for me, but I think it was just too much logic. And I've always been an open-minded person. Like, I would be the one in, like, I used to go to Tea Party rallies and stuff. I'd be the one going, why are we for the drug war? And I would say, and no one could give me rational answers, or don't you think
drugs
it's...
drugs are bad.
Yeah.
Okay.
My favorite thing is how liberals are in favor of drug freedom because they understand that control doesn't work. And conservatives are in favor of gun freedom because they understand control doesn't work. Yet when it comes to drugs, conservatives believe that if you have the government involved, somehow you'll be able to get drugs off the street. And conservatives and liberals believe if you get the government involved, somehow you'll be able to get guns off the street.
It's all it is feels. And let me explain why, okay? The liberal is anti-gun because they just want everyone to be nice to each other. And they think that rational people will be nice to each other if you get guns away. All right, they don't want people just shooting each other because they disagree. They have good intentions in their heart, but they have really bad application theories. All right, conservatives on the drug war, it's a false moral issue for them.
Yeah,
it's a feels. If we give up on this drug war, we're admitting defeat and that the drugs win. You know, it's this thing that really hits home with people, and all people that are against drugs, all they want is people to be safe as well. Exactly, yeah. But you can't. This war on adjectives and nouns is so stupid. Like, I really miss the days where I hate that we live. I live now. I'd much rather live in like the, you know, the late 1800s or early 1900s, where it was, you know, it was Mexico versus, you know, Spain, when it was, we're declaring war on this nation, not this abstract idea. Yes. Yeah, these abstract war ideas, it makes no sense to me. Like you ask even the most hardcore drug enforcement agent who believes what they're doing is righteous to the T, and they would give their life trying to stop drugs. You ask them if you actually think it's possible for them to stop drug use and drug consumption or selling in the United States, and they will flat out tell you no. So why the hell would you even be wasting your goddamn life and time trying to fight something that cannot be won? And number one is a personal choice. Now, there is a case to be made for the 25-year-old meth addict who's injecting their baby with meth. Yeah, there's a problem there, but more government's not going to fix that problem. And there is a problem with a kid taking a rifle or a gun to a high school or a movie theater and shooting up the place. But more government is not going to fix that problem. The thing is people think the government can take away risk in their life. And that's impossible. You can't take away risk. There is risk in breathing air.
Yep.
Plain and simple. You could breathe in a brain-eating amoeba and die tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Wow. Out of the blue, it happens.
Only in Alabama. Go ahead, Daniel. I was just going to wrap up, say, you know, we should give our closing remarks. And I just wanted to say, Justin, thanks a lot for coming on the show. Really a real pleasure having you on.
Thank you so much for having me. I know it was on a dime, but I love coming on with you guys.
Yeah. It's a last minute thing, but it was great conversation. I wanted to say that, you know, things may be crumbling, things may be collapsing, you know, but I think we have to, you know, press ever onward with our message and, you know, speak calmly and patiently with people. And, you know, you're definitely going to encounter people who are, you know, emotionally attached to, you know, whatever political master they have. And if you, you know, you insult their master, they're going to, you know, slave on slave attack you. So that kind of sucks. But still, we, you know, because I think we were all, you know, we didn't know this stuff right when we were young, right? All of us went through government school. We all had the indoctrination. Luckily, we all resisted it, and we continued to ask questions, and our creativity wasn't destroyed. So that's a good thing. You know, I think it was Albert Einstein, right? He says, it's a miracle if creativity survives public education, right? So you know, I think that's positive. I always talk about optimism and, you know, in a bright future, because, You know, I think that's what we have to come across as when we're talking about volunteerism. It's about love, it's about peace, about optimism, you know. And that's like Adam Kokesh, that's his basic philosophy, right? It's all about love and peace, and we gotta show them that this is an attractive philosophy because it makes sense, because it's logical, and because it's compassionate, right? And it's peaceful. So that's usually what I tell people.
Yeah, I really appreciate you coming on such short notice, Justin. Hopefully one day me or Jeremy can get on your one of your podcasts, and you can kind of.
I'd love to have you guys on.
Pick one of our brains.
It'd be a short show if you do, Dave. But you know.
Yeah, I'm very shallow.
He'll get a knock midway through.
I'm intellectually shallow, man. I got nothing to say, really. No, but you know, this, we talked about gun control a large majority of this podcast. But you know, here's if you're at the end of this show, if for some reason you listen to this show and you haven't heard our before shows
for some reason,
especially if you've listened to this thing the whole way through. If you want to get on our Twitter or our Facebook and you want to rationally defend without emotion, you cannot make an emotional argument. You have to make a rational argument. I will debate you until you're tired of it. Because rationally, you cannot be for gun confiscation, gun, any kind of tightening of this gun control situation. And here's the thing. I there was a Gun Sense for America Facebook page, and it had a ton of comments, and I commented, I said, hey, I'm for guns. Is anyone here willing to rationally debate me out of it? I'll go turn in my guns tomorrow if you can rationally debate me out of this. Hmm. And I had two takers, and at the end of the day, they stopped responding when I had them completely pinned up against the wall, and they said they had nothing to say. And I told him, look, I guess you guys are done. Google voluntarism, I'm out. But you know, here's the thing. You can be for or against whatever you want. We're not saying that you can't. I'm just saying you really should check and see if this is an emotional-based thing. Because emotions, you know, when you get hit in the face, your emotions take over. Mm-hmm. All right? And this shooting in Oregon was just a hit in the face. All right? And you don't fight your best when you're seeing red.
Yep.
And so we've got to come together, not by force, but voluntarily we have to come together and figure out a solution to this. And just some common sense solutions would be armed guards at every – I don't know where the marketplace for this has. Somebody's missing out on a lot of money. For especially in these blue states where all these mass gun shootings happen to happen for some reason,
they're not allowed.
Oregon, Aurora, Colorado. Sandy Hook. Democrat.
I don't want to bring up another tangent on this, but just to touch on that point really quick. The Oregon, as far as I know, is an open and concealed carry, at least one, or I believe both, carry state. But the college was a gun-free zone, so they're not. They don't
allow.
Not
even the security could have anything.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You were asking why the market where people are losing out on money. Yeah, people are losing out on money, but it's because of regulations that don't allow them to exist.
All right.
It's the same reason why private security has not overtaken policing in most areas, because of the regulations in most states make it either nearly impossible or at the very least ridiculously expensive for a company to start up a private security company that is allowed to be armed, that is allowed to use lethal force and do all these things. Yeah, that's the one reason why threat management, is that what the thing in Detroit is called?
Cobra or...
That's why they are thriving, because the government is collapsing around them and there's nobody to stop them from saying, hey, we can provide security for you folks.
I want to get that guy on the podcast.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I really do. But to wrap up what I was wanting to say, boycott. If you're going to college right now, you're a college age student. Try to find one that's not a gun-free zone. I don't know if that's possible.
Not possible.
I would guess.
As far as I know, Liberty University is the only university, maybe the only university, or at least it used to be the only one that allowed, that openly admitted that they allowed guns on campus. Hmm. But they are mostly Christian or Catholic school, I think. Liberty,
I believe
U?
So.
I don't
yeah.
know.
But either way, I think from what I remember, that allows it.
I don't know about this Yankee college shit you're talking about.
They're down by you, as far as I know.
Right? I'm joking. But you know, I really appreciate you coming on, Justin. I really appreciate what you're doing. You know, with your Liberty Hangout. Keep doing the man on the street stuff, man.
Yeah. I plan on getting out there. I was thinking of two videos to do. I want to ask people about Bernie Sanders, and then I got the idea today of asking people what are rights. Get people thinking that way, because they think of rights as though I have a right to this, I have a right to that. They think they have a right to things, and when they when they believe they have a right to a thing, in essence, what they're saying is that they have a right to your labor. They have a right to enslave you to get what they desire.
Well, yeah, an American education has done a very poor job of telling people the difference between negative and positive rights. I don't believe political rights exist at all. I don't believe in rights at all. Yep. They're legal fiction. Mm-hmm. But if we're going to play in that paradigm, there's a huge difference between negative and positive rights. And what you just said was a positive right. Hey, my health care should be provided to me by the state. Mm-hmm. That's a positive right. That means the doctor is working for free.
Yep.
You're entitled to his labor. And you know, a negative right is you can't kill me. You can't steal from me. You're not taking a privilege away from someone or forcing someone, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that would be awesome, a video series on that. Just, you'd have to find out which questions would really poll well.
Yeah.
And make a lot of sense to just the common ignoramus, sorry, for a lack of
I think
words.
It may be a good starting point to ask them if they believe healthcare is right, is education right, because those are going to be the areas that really resonate with the college crowd.
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. Especially while you're on college, on the campus, you should do it. You should sit outside and do all kinds of questions. You know, hey, I'm doing this for class. Would you ask?
Oh, they'll know it's not for class.
Oh, no, they would. Yeah, I'm just doing some political bullshit for class.
Volunteers in 101, right?
Yeah, right. There you go. Hey, well, Cal gets away with it down in Virginia, right? He just stands out in the colleges and rakes the people in.
Yeah, he does.
Well, I'll just finish up by saying, you know, obviously, I appreciate you coming on the show as well. It was great to finally, you know, kind of meet you after, you know, we've been back and forth on Twitter for a while now. I mean, I would definitely, if you're willing to keep going out there and doing those videos, absolutely, man, go for it. I mean, it's one of the things we've talked about around here. I've said I want to go do it. I've just never actually gotten around to do it. But I'm going to tell you, that's what I was going to say, man. I hate the city with a passion. I try to stay out of it
like you get arrested
purposes,
every time you go.
Yeah, I do run into problems when I go there. The last time I was there, I was thrown in a cage.
Jeremy has a problem with authority. That's the problem.
Yes, I do.
You didn't get spanked enough as a child.
For this purpose, I may make an exception. So, because you were saying earlier, you know, you're a one-man crew with this, and with these things, I've just learned over the because we I've tried to get Danilo to come down here, but we can never work our schedules out to do it.
You're not. Jeremy.
But we
Jeremy,
can. No, we
Jeremy.
Should, yeah,
Jeremy.
We
should, what? Jeremy, you know why Danilo won't come?
Because he's busy with the hot homeschooling moms. I know.
Jeremy, what you're not.
Jeremy's going to take the Eastern European women, right? And I'm going to take the homeschooling mothers.
Okay, your
And then Justin will take the college.
Oh, I forgot about the Eastern European.
All right, listen, you're friends with the homeschooling moms. I got assaulted by the Eastern European woman. There's a big difference, okay?
Anyway, to close off,
absolutely, man. We should definitely hook up. And if you know you want, we'll try to work something out. Because even if it's just for me being the one holding the camera for you, man, I'd... It seems to work better in pairs when you do these things. Yeah, so we should
go down to Times Square. We'll get all the New York maniacs.
Absolutely, man. And hell yeah, man. I mean, you were saying that, you know, your first one, you know, you only got two, you know, that first one, you only got two, talk to two people and, you know, you may push toward. It's a learning experience, man. Just like I said, honestly, I give you props for getting out there and even trying it because it's one of those things I've talked about. Never doing it, but screw it, man. We'll get together one of these days. We'll do this. But thanks again for coming on. This was a lot of fun. And, you know, I echo a lot of what Dave says when it comes to gun control. If you don't want them, don't have them. Just don't tell me I can't because I'm not going to bother you as long as you don't want to remove my guns from me. That's all.
Yeah. This is my closing remarks here. I think that what we need to do And I think that I may be a hypocrite for saying the word we for what I'm going to follow this up with. Now, for any of the statists listening, if there is a single statist listening right now, I would say that what we need to do is kind of start seeing the world in terms of actions. We have this tendency to look at the world through words. We want to look for an adjective or a noun to describe everything, whether it's anarchist, statist, government, things like that, business even. But when we take a step back and start looking at the world for action, individuals doing business with each other, voluntarily interacting, when we look at government for the actions it's doing, it's really just individuals implying force to get what they desire. So I think that when we, as I'm a hypocrite here again for saying we, but once the people of society can really start seeing the world for what it is, I think that we'll really be able to take a step forward towards peace. And I just I read an article on Mises yesterday that was talking about how centralized societies are coming to a close. And I agree 100% that I believe it is man's natural evolution here that we are starting to decentralize. We see it now with technology. It's empowering the individual like never before. And I just think that going forward, this is going to very quickly become a very decentralized society where everything as we know it, from governments to central banks to businesses, going to be broken down. We're going to see the world for what it is, a world of beautiful individuals with different and unique desires.
Yeah, just look at, just to play onto your point, just look at how big and booming the locally grown organic X, you know, whatever food is blowing up. People don't want this Costco mailed in from China shit anymore. They want local stuff, and it is better. It's better for you. Yep. And I think things are going to become more decentralized. The internet has this weird way of centralizing us all and decentralizing us.
Absolutely.
And it's really weird. Like, I'm in Alabama. I'm talking to three guys from New York, and I would have never known you guys 50 years ago.
Yeah.
Or 20 years ago, I probably would have never known you.
10 years ago, even.
Yeah, 10 years ago. So just how fast and rapid things are changing, I really think that freedom is inevitable.
Yeah, we may even see it in our lifetime.
Especially if this anti-aging pill goes through. They got the workout pill they're working on where it tricks your body into thinking it worked out.
I just hope you don't get killed in a no-knock raid and we'll be able to see it.
Well,
yeah, Dave, for your new house, I would highly suggest you putting a security system in that's patched to our channel so we can watch it at all times. So when it does finally happen, at least we have record of it.
We have a live broadcast.
I was thinking about putting like a safety button like on my nightstand, you know, like I hear a bump in the night, boom, it turns on all the cameras in the house, all the lights, all the cameras. Alarms.
Just be careful though.
Trespassers will be shot.
I don't want to have to say Dave's not here, man, and mean it. So
No, I'm a pretty passive and a peaceful person. I don't really get into too many scuffles, and you know, I hate to say it, but I'm pretty much one of the biggest law abiding citizens you'll ever meet.
Statist.
Whatever you want to say, man. I don't really like to ruffle people's feathers in a physical manner, more in a mental or with my voice, you know.
Yeah. What you said, Justin, reminds me of a quote. I forget who said it. Society reveres their live conformists and dead troublemakers. Right. So, you know, voluntarists, you know, we're like the abolitionists of the 19th century, right? We, you know, completely, you know, anomalies, and everybody was against them, and then they become the future. And now everybody, you know, it is fashionable to be against chain slavery, right? But it is not yet fashionable to be against statism or government.
Like you were saying in the podcast last night, once it becomes fashionable, no one's going to – they'll be looked at as crazy for suggesting it.
Bandwagon.
Yep.
No, Justin, before we get off of this thing, what's your favorite quote of all time? I ask all of our guests.
My favorite quote of all time? I can't even think of anything off the top of my head. But I did have a big one that I was a fan of a year ago. It's been a while since I actually thought of it yesterday. Have you ever heard the quote from Dietrich Bonhoeffer where he says, not to speak is to speak, not to act is to act.
I haven't heard that one. I'm not familiar.
I forget how exactly it begins. It said something about, it begins, silence in the face of evil is itself evil. God will not hold us guiltless, not to speak is to speak, not to act is to act.
That's a good quote, man. I like that.
Cool.
Good one.
Right. Very nice. So thanks a lot for the conversation. So if anybody listening wants to support us, first of all, share, comment, subscribe to the channel. That will definitely help us to spread the message. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Seeds of Liberty podcast. You can find all those links on theseedsofliberty.com. If you want to support us monetarily, PayPal or – oh, no, sorry, Bitcoin or Patreon. I keep forgetting. Bitcoin or Patreon. Please support us. We love to do it.
$1 a month. That's all we ask.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we say like if every subscriber just gave $1 a month, you know, that'd be beautiful, you know, and, you know, we're not asking for 10% of your income. So, whatever you can give can help the,
I can go buy a Pope hat if you want. And then we can start demanding 10%. I mean, you must tithe to the Church of the Liberty, right?
You need a badge.
I'll get a badge and I'll get a Pope hat. I'll double it up.
Listen, I'll finally get the Church of the Immaculate Secession off the ground and then we can work on that.
Nice. So awesome conversation. Thanks a lot, gentlemen. So this is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace. Bye.